this video journal is going to be on just a concise account of some factual points, like in other testimonies and having to regurgitate things that haven't been listened to and officially denied. I tend to go off on tangents and include facts I know and conjecture, so I'm going to stick to some just factual points. But this is a consequence of being phoned on Christmas Eve morning by points of access out of the blue. Now, I was not made aware of this, or that the GP that referred me to them was concerned. Now, personally, I perceive, and I can only wonder what her motive was, but I've had nothing to do with her. I've never met this woman. She's not my GP. She doesn't represent me, and the doctor preceding her wasn't a fair representation of me anyway, because as I will give an account and witness of her behaviour as a medical professional, you'll see why I refused the registration of that GP service. So I can only wonder why I was referred to points of access. I since looked up points of access on the internet. It's a NHS Mental Health Services, a triage, whatever a triage is. I can only presume it's a triangulation of witnesses, of referrals that get their heads together and make a decision on behalf of another individual whether that person needs a medical intervention. That's my hypothesis. I don't know. I haven't examined it thoroughly. But my concern is, if you get two false witnesses to convince the third, it's going to be one word against another. So that's my concern. Why has a doctor that I simply asked to be unregistered to and mentioned I'd like some of my medical records adjusted because they were biased? And this biasness affects the next medical body because it's lawfully stated that this happened when it didn't. So I'm going to go over some points to just give the facts of my medical history, my brother's medical history, his car accident and death, the circumstances, and my mother's treatment in her care. And now I could give hours on the good treatment we've all received from medical professionals, but you know, sadly, I'm going to be focusing on the bad. So I'm going to be giving an account. Now, it's Christmas Day, you know, and if these people are concerned about my health, well, they're not concerned that they've triggered me and I've had anxious headaches all day, you know, just worrying. Well, what's going to come of this? So I'm making this video to pass onto these services if they come knocking at my door, because I'm not going to put my trust in them. So I'm going to be handing them this video and some other videos that I've journalised. So I want to just start with just considering, well, what's the motive, what has been used as the motive. And I personally believe they're trying to have me sectioned because I've got their back up. You know, they don't like it, they don't like being told, they don't like being stood up to. Perhaps it's pride, I don't know, or perhaps it's a cover-up for their own misbehaviour, and they're trying to put the onus on me to get me sectioned, or they're just doing it out of spite, just to wind me up, just a little, you know, in the face of legitimate reason. But if they got any sense about, you know, this doctor spoke to me on the phone claiming she knew about traumatic stress disorder, so she knows about anxiety triggers and opening the wounds, you know, and that's what you've done to me, and I'm quite rightly, I can sue you, and I possibly will do, but I'm going to give an account, and it's possibly some of the things I've written or posted on YouTube, they're going to deem me paranoid about electronic harassment. You know, I know that this is factual evidence. I'm going to put some videos, including on a memory stick, of Professor Barry Trower. He was a military, worked for military intelligence. He's also a professor at Plymouth University, where he was. he was trained by the military in electronic warfare. So I've learned and studied on countless areas of the technology that the British military got, the American military have got, all on stealth weapons, on electronic magnetic pulse weapons. And these have been used covertly to aggravate and target individuals, and I've experienced this firsthand. So if that's one of the reasons you're referring me to a mental health service, you're going to be going up against some factual documentation that can be established in law, but it's a fact. So you can't prove either way whether it's used against me or not. Only I know that it was my mother and father, and this home was bombarded by electronic magnetic high frequencies, not low frequencies, these were very high bursts and pulses of targeted stealth weapons through the wall, you know, to make you sick, to aggravate you. And I know the frequencies can cause agitation, anger, they can stimulate sexual appetites. Different frequencies can be used for different instrumentation. It's like same as in crowd control. Certain frequencies can make people feel sick, cause pain, cause confusion, cause anger. You know, the police tetra frequency makes people aggressive. That's been proven. That's been scientifically tested. And the law states that like these smart weapons by the British Gas are pushing for people to have, claiming that they're safe. Well, the scientific evidence opposes what the status quo is, what's been sold as fact, which when you examine and weigh up both accounts by the... Now, Barry Trower was officially commissioned by the government to deem if Wi-Fi was safe in schools, and he condemned it, and he knows what he's talking about. He was trained in every area of this technology by the military. And he's got a PhD in the physics of this technology, so he knows what he's talking about. And his account was rejected, and he on his own back, protested and went and warned people about the dangers of Wi-Fi and the biological damage. There's also a doctor, Dr. Mallory Blythe, who can prove, who's shown that electronic harassment causes biological symptoms, and it can cause cancer, brain tumours, Alzheimer's, dementia. It can replicate mental health symptoms, and it's used stealthily against people. But she done a talk at a conference about the harmful effects of low ionizing radiation, how, like, from mobile phones, from telecom masts, satellite pulses, all this technology is bad for your health. But the government won't accept that because they won't make any money, so they get full science. But there's even accounts of the scientists admitting that they were threatened to indirectly to pass it off as safe when it isn't safe, because there's so much money made out of it. So if that's one of the motives why they're going to try and say, oh, you're concerned about your mental health because you're paranoid. Well, I'm not paranoid. I know what I've experienced. I just wanted to throw that in the mix. So I'm going to give an account of my brother's death, my mother's treatment, and covering up her the malpractice that she experienced, and go through the history. I'll start with my brother. Now, my brother at 21 had a car crash. He was a passenger, and he broke his tibia and fibula, also broke his arm, and had his face smashed in. The driver hit a tree. Coincidentally, there's another young man who had exactly the same injuries, who was knocked off his motorbike by the police pulling out of Farnborough police station, and they had identical injuries to my brother. Now, I was working in Aldershot. My brother's accident was in Aldershot, and he was taken to Cambridge Military Hospital, and I visited him in the accident emergency, and then the following day when he was treated and put on a ward. Now I was working in Aldershot and finished early and popped in to see him, and I walked in on my brother was pulling his bed sheets off himself, and his eyes were white and his eyelids were rolling, his eyes were rolling in his head, and I was calling out for help and I was being ignored. And the nurse on the ward walked past me very uncomfortably and shiftily and wouldn't do anything about it, and I followed her up the ward calling out to her in shock, why was she ignoring me and why won't she do anything to help my brother? That went on for about 10-15 minutes, and she just coldly went back to her desk, to the desk, and tried to ignore me. And I was shouting, why won't you treat my brother? So I walked on something very suspicious. As I went into the ward, there was a girl in my brother's year with a new cast on her leg, and she was grinning at me. I thought that was very strange. And after they were ignoring me, a whole group of people turned up on the ward and asked me to leave. And then I headed home, and as I got home, trying to explain to my mother and father what I'd witnessed and how they ignored my plea, because my brother was clearly in distress, and I could perceive he was losing oxygen, and they were just completely ignoring him and myself. And I was just getting into a state of disbelief. I was disassociated. I just couldn't believe it. And I was only 17. And as I was trying to explain to my mum, they'd already received a phone call that my brother had been rushed into intensive care. So they weren't really listening to my concerns. So I followed them back to the hospital, and we were waiting and talked through the routine of going into intensive care, and we was waiting outside the intensive care ward before we went into intensive care. And this young officer come up to my mum shaking, and my mum was feeling sympathetic for his difficulty and his state. He was in a state of trembling and fear, and my mother tried to comfort him and get him to, so he could tell us what he wanted to tell us. Before he was able to tell us something, and it's quite clear he wanted to tell us something very serious, because it really affected him. An officer, higher ranking officer, up the end of the corridor spotted him, screamed at him, you effing C, get your backside up here. And he was marched out of our way and into an office, and the door was slammed, and we could hear all this shouting and abuse at him. And it was, struck us hard and disconcerting. Well, what did he want to tell us? And then we was called into intensive care, and we scrubbed up, went through all the routine and the discipline, and got to my brother's side. He was unconscious. They put him in an induced coma. And next to him was this other guy who had had exactly the same injury. His name was Richard. Now, where I was working in my previous job, I was working right below where the father of this man. And I thought, well, is that a coincidence? They had exactly the same injuries, identical injuries, you know. So on the ward there was two young men in their prime, and they were both 21 with identical injuries, and this mistreatment and this omission of giving my brother the care, and being in shock as a family, and then speaking to Richard's parents, my mother and father sitting in the same room, and my mum and dad were called to the side, and we were told, oh, Mark's going to live and Richard's not. You know, my mum was disgusted by that, and in hindsight, because they say that hindsight, 20/20, 20/20 vision, you look back and see things in the continuity of events. And in hindsight, to me, it was to drive a wedge. So my mum would be disabled to speak and correlate any knowledge, because I think it was done on the back of guilt. So this device was used to stop my mother speaking to the parents to put two and two together. Perhaps, I don't know. I'm just stating what happened. So that made it very difficult for the relationship between my mum and Richard's mum. So it kind of put a wedge in, because my mum, I can't remember if my mum actually said anything to Jill, which was the mum's name. But that turned out to be a load of rubbish, because they both died. And so the inquest was, the police never took a statement. My brother was working for a company in Fleet called First Inertia, which is First Impact, you know, firstborn son, First Impact, whether that's a coincidence. And on the day of the accident, my brother was on the top of the stairs at home. I just passed my driving test, and he was very heavy. And I was very concerned for him, thinking, well, what's on your mind? And he couldn't tell me, and he was really troubled about going out to where he was invited to, because he was invited out by a work colleague, and that's when the accident happened, on the way to a party. Now, I don't know what he was involved in or what had happened, but something was really troubling my brother, so I can only speculate on what it was, but it's kind of like he was very troubled by something. And whether that was intuition or not, I don't know. But I tried to talk him out of going, and I was taking a friend to play golf, so I invited him. I said, come along with me, you don't have to go out. You know, you can come with me. And as I arrived at the golf course, I witnessed a car accident with my friend, and then thought nothing of it. And then when I got home, I'd heard that my brother had been in it. We'd been notified, my parents had been notified my brother's in an accident. We had to get out of the hospital. So that was, that was the end of my day. I got home to the news my brother had been in a car accident, broke his leg, and I saw him in the intensive care and the following day on the ward, where they refused to treat him. The police never took a statement of my brother, and the inquest was done and dusted before it started, and it was just a whitewash. And my parents were in so much shock. You just can't put two and two together in such a state. But in hindsight, it all seemed to be covered up all nice and neatly. And the offending driver was told just to keep his mouth shut, you know. And that was done in the earshot of my parents. You know, don't say anything so you don't condemn yourself. That's basically what his solicitor advised. We didn't have a solicitor or anything, any representation. It just went straight through the court, magistrate's court in Aldershot. So looking in hindsight, it's very suspicious. And also, I look at a few years later, I hear of, I think it was an anaesthetist in America, and another witness from an ex-CIA operative who mentioned ways of that the American military intelligence used to kill people to make it look like natural causes. And we were told that the marrow in the bones gets into the bloodstream, and it's a very rare case. But in this case, it happened to two 20-year-olds with exactly the same injury on the same day. And you think, well, that's a bit of a coincidence. And then years later, I hear this account of an injection which the CIA used to induce this effect to make it look, on the back of it's given a medical name, it's given a legitimised symptom. It's, you know, I can't remember what it was called, fatty embolisms getting to the blood. But hearing this account of it's induced by a covert injection added to my suspicions, and I thought, well, it's all very strange. And the way it was laid out, it was like the two thieves on the cross, because they had their legs broken. And then following this, I get voice-to-skull technology and voices targeting me and in my head, and I thought I was going mad. And it was all to do with Jesus and that event, you know, whether that was the trauma of it. But later on, learning about military stealth weapons and covert targeting and MK Ultra, Alan Dulles and Dr. David Cameron, and learning that these actual practices, social engineering, and covertly on unsuspecting public members, and it's all through British history, and it runs through American and Canadian history, and it even stems back to the Nazis, the Gestapo, and the methods of social engineering, dark social engineering, testing these voice-to-skull weapons. And the voice-to-skull was used in the Iraq War as a weapon to deceive the Iraqi army to put down their weapons, as the intelligence body were feigning to be Allah, and speaking the voice of God. That's why it's called V2K, voice-to-skull, you know, they call it the voice of God weapon. And in hindsight, you know, I think that technology was used on me to persecute me. And that followed my brother's death. And then regarding the two thieves on the cross, it was all to do with that. And I look back in hindsight and wonder, and I'm pretty sure it was a ritual sacrifice, and the method used was an injection to induce that. And that was practiced in a military hospital, and that's what that man was trying to tell us. Because he was definitely trying to tell us something, and he was fearing for his life. And he got caught. And we never heard anything else about it. We never saw that man again. Don't know what happened to that man. It's not like we can inquire about it, because we're not going to be told. But that smacked a suspicion, looking back at it in hindsight. But at the time, it was just all such a shock. We were devastated, and then the persecution followed me. Now I didn't know at the time, but I was suffering from post-traumatic stress from a violent injury from my grandfather, who triggered and threw me out of the wheelbarrow over some broken glass, and I was covered in lacerations and cuts, and the shock of it, and seeing the blood. Because I was head to toe in blood. I was just covered in blood because it was oozing out all the cuts in my arms, my legs, my chest. And then my granddad tried to chase me down. That's when I completely shattered and just went blank. And so I blanked out that memory, and there's other things that happened, but I'm not going to go into that. And I completely blanked out that memory, although I had all the scars over my arms and legs. I just never put the two. I'd look at the scars and it just wouldn't even cross my mind where they come from. They were just there. And I disassociated and compartmentalised the trauma. And I was suffering the symptoms throughout my development and throughout my life. And there's the suspicions around my birth. My father went missing. He can't remember where he was. And the one who abused me was at my mother's birth, and I turned in the womb violently until I couldn't breathe, until that's what my mother was told, and she was recounting the story that I was, apparently the umbilical cord choked me and starved me of oxygen because I was born blue and facing up, and my mum said it was a very difficult birth. But researching medical history, you cannot kink the, because the oxygen is supplied by the blood supply, and you can't, the umbilical cord's designed so it can be kinked and knotted, and it won't stop the flow of blood or water or whatever's fed into the baby, but you can't constrict the blood vessels, so the oxygen and blood doesn't suffer, asphyxiate the child. So I don't believe that the account my mum was given is accurate. I believe it was induced, and that was to cause trauma. And the fact that the person who abused me, who I believe is in the military, and I believe he was triggered, he just lost it, and then nearly tried to kill me as a two-year-old. But I escaped, and it was made aware by my... I got into the safety of my gran and my nan and my mother, screaming my heart out, and my granddad came running around the corner all sheepish and bright red, because he got caught what he was up to. I don't think he knew what was going on, and I personally believe he was triggered, or something happened to him in the army, and his training kicked in and he completely snapped. One minute he was fine, the next minute he was this killer, this beast. And so adding up the trauma and then my birth circumstances, and wondering why my father wasn't there, and he can't remember. My father's completely dissociated about the whole event. And I ask him about my brother's birth, he can recall every detail. But he just cannot, and he's never been out of it. He just looks, his eyes roll, he just can't work out why he can't remember. He generally can't remember. And then so that's very suspicious. You know, how was he kept away? Where was he? You know, and why was my granddad at my mother's birth? You know, there wasn't any difficulty between my mum and my dad, and there wasn't any question of him not being the father or anything like that. It was, he just can't remember. He was absent without leave. And my dad suffers, I can tell by the symptoms, he suffers from disassociation. So that's another red flag and suspicion that makes me question the circumstances of my trauma. And it's trauma in the womb, then the isolated trauma of my granddad, because that was all covered up and lied about. And because I compartmentalised it, I never mentioned it, because I was completely unaware of it until after my mum died. And all the memories come flooded back, because I could tell my mum had been carrying the guilt, and she was the guilt was eating her, and I couldn't figure out why is she feeling so guilty about me, what she done. And then it dawned on me, and then the memories came back, and I remembered the event, and my mum must have felt so guilty about concealing it. Why did she conceal it? Was she protecting her father? You know, he should have been done for manslaughter. What was the motive? What was the involvement with my mum? She knew something, but she couldn't tell me. So there's another trauma circumstance, my brother circumstances, all very suspicious. And then my brother was 21, I was about 17, 18, and suffering from these post-traumatic stress disorder. And all this trauma throughout my life, and the symptoms, the shock waves of the events, but not really associating the symptoms to the trauma, because I was disconnected from the trauma, completely traumatized. But I was experiencing the repercussions, and I had post-traumatic stress disorder, and also I was dissociated, so my development was completely arrested. Everything was a difficulty for me. School, everything, social life, everything. So I developed this, you know, I was in a fight or flight mode all the time. I was either passive or just wild. I couldn't figure out why. You know, it was very difficult to navigate. And you just labelled as a problem. And then my mum must have felt guilty, because she would have known what the symptoms were. So she would overcompensate. And, you know, looking in hindsight, I could wonder why she was trying to make it up. I used to find her smothering. I used to push my mother away, and didn't want anything to do with her, although I didn't trust her, kind of thing. But I didn't know why I didn't. And anyway, after my brother's died, I was in complete complete bits, and I couldn't work, and I'd been through three jobs. I was on my third job after I left school. I was working at the council for the gardens in Aldershot, and I just couldn't deal with it. I couldn't face, just couldn't cope through the day or anything. I was in complete smashed in bits, and eventually they tried to keep my, I just never turned up for work, and they kept my job open for as long as they can, and eventually said, you know, we've got to let you go. And I said, oh, that's fair enough. And my mum was like, hard, you know, well, you're not living here for nothing, you've got to go out to work, or you've got to go and sign on. So I went to, I was in a position where I had to go either get a job or sign on, so I went to sign on. And again, I wasn't really able to work, so it was kind of disingenuous. So somebody spotted the difficulty, because they kept disciplining me, and I just ignored it. I was a bit rebellious as well. And then they sent me downstairs for an assessment and said, look, clearly you need help, why don't you go to a doctor and speak to a doctor? So that's what I did. And our family GP was Dr. Barrack. Dr. Barrack referred, I told her the difficulty that had happened after my brother's death, and drinking problems, I couldn't stop drinking. And I'd also got into a bit of pot, because I was getting so drunk, I'm hungover, I didn't like it. So one of my brother's friends advised, so try a bit of pot, there's no side effects, it's just a bit hashish. So, I tried that, and it was, I won't legitimise it as good, but it was better than drink, so I swapped one for the other. And I was referred to psychiatrist Dr. Rutherford, Finley Park Hospital. Went to the outpatient's appointment. As soon as I walked through the door, she was just dismissive of me, didn't want to know about what I was suffering. And as soon as I mentioned pot, she screamed her head off at me, you're a waste of space, you're wasting my time, get out of my office. And I was in shock, I couldn't believe it. I'm a very honest person, so I called a spade. And so I left her office before I sat down and recounted what I'd been through. She was completely cold as ice, and threw me out of her office as a disgrace. And I went back to Dr. Barrack and said, I'm just finding it difficult to cope, and I want to end it, but I don't want to put my parents through that. And she looked at me with contempt and said, oh, there's a railway line over there, go and do it. And that really tore me inside, and I just shouted in her, spat in her face, called her a bitch really loudly, and I was banished from the surgery. And I just plummeted to rock bottom, and I broke down outside the surgery in absolute devastation. You know, being told that they would help me and then being treated like that, because I mentioned that I smoked a bit of pot. You know, it's completely out of context. And subsequently, years later, my lung collapsed, and I was in the x-ray department, and my medical file was put on my chest. Now, I was in my 30s by this time, early 30s, so this was like about 15 years after the event. And I happened to read my file of what Dr. Rutherford had put, and Dr. Rutherford had written, oh, what a lovely person I was, and she's really concerned about me. And there's no record of what Dr. Barrack told me to do. She told me to go and throw myself on the railway. And I left that surgery, and I was quite shocked when I read that, and I thought, well, that's not what happened. So they're obviously covered up there. They obviously felt guilty and covered up their mistake. And so I knew that, you know, something was afoot when I received that revelation from reading my medical records. Whether that's been changed or still available, I don't know. But what was written was not true to the events that actually written. She was contemptuously treating me like a dog. in hindsight, it was, I honestly feel that it was deliberate. And then Dr. Barrack's behaviour was deliberate. But subsequently, after breaking down, after that appointment, being told to kill myself, I decided to I'll go back home. And I recounted the event to my mother. She was disgusted. And she said, well, just try another surgery, give it one more go. And I made an appointment to see a doctor at Jenner House Surgery, and it was a young Scottish doctor. She was quite young, and I think she was newly practicing there. It's her first station at a doctor's surgery. And I recounted the events and the symptoms I was suffering, but I didn't really have didn't know what those symptoms were. So I didn't know how to articulate what I was going through. I was completely dissociated and worried that people wouldn't believe how difficult it was for me. And, you know, I was treated with that scar of how I was treated by Dr. Rutherford and Dr. Barrack. It sort of biased my behaviour, and it biased any follow-up from professionals after that. So I spoke to this Scottish doctor, a young woman, and she agreed to help me if I helped myself, which I agreed to go along with. And she actually put official a complaint in against Dr. Barrack, and I was referred to a voluntary counselling agency, which turned out to be bad, because at the counselling agency there was a Mormon high priest who groomed me into the Mormon church and into his home. And that went all sour, you know, that was really bad for me. And he'd done some meditations which I felt very violating, and that caused further anxiety and triggered within me more anxiety and problems. And then subsequently I was groomed into the Mormon church because I was a believer in Jesus Christ and had a testimony of Jesus Christ, but I wasn't aware of the Mormon faith, the heretical beliefs of the Mormon Church, and I was indoctrinated and lied to about what they believe, and I didn't find out later on that I'd been lied to. So that was a bad event. But anyway, after two counselling sessions, this was before I went into this high priest home, I went back to a follow-up appointment just to let my doctor know how I was doing, and she wanted me to keep her informed. So this was like 2 weeks after the initial, or a few weeks after the initial counselling, two sessions, and I had an appointment with my GP to follow up. When I got to the surgery to announce my appointment, I was screamed at and told to get out. And this is following the official complaint against Dr. Barrack, and being advised to go to this counselling service to help myself in the condition that she would agree to help me. When I went back, they told me, and I kind of couldn't work out why I was being treated like a criminal. They were contemptuous, and you're not welcome here. You're not on the surgery anymore. And I said, well, why? What's happened? Oh, I had an appointment to see Dr. Soane, I can't remember her name. And she said that they told me that she no longer practices here, and you've been struck off the register. And I said, well, why? What is the reason? And they said, we don't have to give you a reason, get out. And that was the last I heard of that. And a few years later, I needed a doctor, because by that time I'd had enough of putting my trust in people. And eventually replacing Dr. Barrack, came along Dr. Fairburn from Alexander Road Surgery. And so that was our family GP. Our first family GP was a Dr. Hamill. And Dr. Hamill, I think, retired or passed away. I think he had cancer. And then he was replaced by Dr. Barrack. That was our second GP. And our third family GP was Dr. Fairburn, Olive Fairburn. And my mum said, well, I said, my mum referred me. She said, I'll put a referral into you. I was reluctant to get a doctor, but I needed a doctor because I had, I think I had pneumonia and I was really ill, bronchial pneumonia. I couldn't get out of bed. And my mum referred me, you know, spoke to Dr. Fairbairn. Dr. Fairbairn put all these conditions on my mum because of the account of Dr. Barrett. So I don't know what was said or written, but it biased the way I was treated by Dr. Fairbairn. And when I got to see Dr. Fairbairn, she said, I don't want any trouble from you. And I kind of thought, well, what have you been told? You know, why have you said that? Obviously, you're aware of what happened, because I told her what about Dr. Barrett. And she didn't. She said, well, we don't want to deal with that. I'm not going to deal with that. I'm going to forget that. So that was the foundation of my care with Dr. Fairbairn. It's very biased. So that was always underpinning the way I was treated. I was treated like, you know, I was in the wrong. I wasn't in the wrong. You know, I put my trust in these people and they let me down. And I was well behaved with Dr. Barrett, but I was too passive. You know, I didn't question anything and didn't really get anywhere. And so that was my medical history. And I'd only ever go and see a doctor if I really needed to. And I really needed to be signed off work. And she signed me, referred me to a psychiatrist, a psychologist, and eventually, because I didn't know I was suffering post-traumatic stress, but I was severely depressed. I couldn't cope, I couldn't function, and I'd had sent to a neurologist and discovered I had a frontal lobe impairment, and that's like that. That's very similar to a head injury, and I believe that was from the trauma in the womb. And I personally believe that was induced. There's something very suspicious about the reasons they give. And then I discovered that you can't asphyxiate the baby by wrapping the cord around its neck, because it's designed to get into a knot, and the blood flow will still flow because of the way the arteries are in a figure of eight. They're like that. You can't kink them, you bend them, and there's always a flow, a constant flow of blood. So that wouldn't have starved me of oxygen. Something else starved me of oxygen and made me recoil in the womb violently. Personally, I believe that's something my mother was induced with, and that causes trauma and brain damage. And I personally perceive that's deliberate. And then my father being absent, both him and my grandfather working for the M.O.D. is all very suspicious. But you know, can only speculate. I'm on the end of it. I have no factual evidence, so I may never know. But it's very suspicious. And so that was my medical history. And I eventually got a Med 4 certificate, and reluctantly. And Dr. Fairbairn said, you know, don't come to me if you're getting hounded by the Department of Work and Pensions, because I don't want it, she said. You know, she didn't like any. I was always being threatened, and then I was always being told, oh no, I don't want any burden, I don't want you to put any pressure on me. And I thought, well, where's all this coming from? You don't even know me. I was in and out of her office in about 10 minutes, and I only went to see the doctor if I had a genuine reason. And I was always treated biasly, with contempt, and I couldn't figure out why she treated me like that. And then I learned she was treating my mum like that. She was patronising my mum, talking her down like a little girl. And so it all dawned on me that, you know, it was all staged treatment, stage managed. It seemed to be like, appeared to be stage managed treatment, like we were like these little broken victims that she could bully around. And it all became apparent to me when my mum became ill. And now my mum had been through breast cancer, and she'd had a brain tumour. She'd been referred to St George's Hospital from Frindley Park to have her tumour removed. all this bias treatment followed, and not towards my mum, but towards me. Now, somebody cancelled the staff at St. George's that me and my dad weren't interested in my mum, and that was the, you know, that's what they were stating, and we can care less. But the truth was, I'd had a car accident that had been covered up. I hadn't been treated by Alexander Road Surgery. The ambulance report was false. The police account of the speed was false. And I was made to feel like a criminal at the scene. And I wasn't at fault. It was somebody drove straight into the back of me without seeing me. And I was left at the scene in complete shock. And on cloud nine, I was so pumped with adrenaline. And that wasn't flagged up by the ambulance driver. He just put everything was normal. All my symptoms were normal. He didn't even check me out. And in hindsight, you know, I disassociate in these circumstances. It's not till afterwards I look back and found out that they'd falsified the speed of the accident, and so it looked on paper that nothing happened. So I had I woke up in the morning, like, I kept jolting up in my bed. And once the adrenaline worn off by that evening, it started to sink in how painful it was, and my throat, my jowls had all popped out my throat. My head felt like I was frightened to relax my neck in case, because it was loose. I couldn't support the weight of my head. The only way I could hold my head up was with my muscles. So all my throat was popped out. I couldn't remember the whole day before. I'd wake up and couldn't remember anything the day before. My symptoms lasted for about 2 years. Couldn't put my head on the pillow. And I was too frightened to move my head too quickly. So I was stuck in my room, you know, just resting all day, sitting in my chair. Frightened to move my head, difficult, painful to move my head, and it would crunch, still crunches today, and I still get violent tension and headaches, and I was worried about it, but a bit concerned that I wasn't going to get any help, because I hadn't received help that far. And after 2 years of recovery, I made an appointment with my doctors, but my doctor was away. I saw another doctor. They patronised me and said, oh, it's just whiplash. And then sent me away. I wasn't satisfied with that because I was concerned and I knew that the symptoms were serious. And the speed of the accident was over 40. Both cars were written off, so I knew it was over 40 miles an hour. It wasn't, you know, what they wrote. It was 20 miles an hour. But the insurance claim is worth for two written off cars. And you can't write two cars off at 20 miles an hour. Hers was completely crunched. How the engine block was pushed up against the dashboard. You couldn't turn the wheels at the front of her car. They completely crumpled. And my dad's car, I was borrowing my dad's car, completely crushed against the back wheels. Even the police, they rifled my car, making out I was up to something, up to no good, treating me like a criminal. And they helped pull. Because I was left on the scene. I couldn't drive home. They couldn't care less what I was doing. And the policeman pulled the, got his foot on the wheel arches and juggled with all his effort to pull the wheel arches off them, because they'd have been rubbing on the back wheels. And he pulled both wheel arches away from them because the whole back was crumpled. And he checked the petrol tank, said, oh, you'll be all right, you can drive home in that. And I was in shock, and I had to drive home in a state of absolute fear. I didn't want to get in the car. I was left at the scene, the ambulance took the old lady to hospital, and I was left there in shock. So I had to drive home, and I got home, and just went straight to bed, and that's when the pain hit me. So 2 years after recovering, all the symptoms, jolting up in bed at night, reliving the accident in slow motion, and just completely undermined my trust in how that they could cover that up, and how the falsify the information, and then to find that had the support of the local surgery, so they were reluctant to treat me. And then I saw my doctor following the first dismissal and appointment. I was just whiplash, and I told my doctor, well, it's not more bit more than whiplash, I'd like to see a specialist. And she refused helping me to get to I wanted to be referred to the hospital to have an MRI scan. She wouldn't do it. She said, you can apply for money and a specialist. She said, we haven't got the money, you're going to have to pay for it yourself. And I had to qualify for the money. She gave me the forms and request to see a specialist. And I requested a specialist, got a specialist and the money. I was qualified for the money. It went off for a review and it come back that I'd got the money. And the only specialist was Aldershot Virgin Health Clinic, and the specialist was supposed to be an expert in neck injury or back injury, but I never saw that person. I saw a physiotherapist, and the physiotherapist said, blurted out their mouth before they examined me, oh, I can give you six sessions of physiotherapy. And I said, well, you haven't looked at me yet. I've qualified for proper examination to see if there's any if there's any symptoms. And then she dismissed there's a problem. I said, well, you haven't even looked at me, how can you diagnose me without examination? Oh, it's just your stance, you just got whiplash. And I thought, oh, you know completely round-rolled by this patronizing, it's like a bloke woman, like a butch feminist. They completely talked down to me like I was some little bitch, and I just went, oh yeah, whatever, and got out of there and complained to my doctor. I said, look, that's completely unfair, and I wanted that changed off my record, but that was never done, not to my knowledge. And also after I was helped with the Med 4 certificate, I wanted to further investigate and have a fresh start, because I was diagnosed with ADHD and that wasn't sitting comfortably with me. And I wanted a fresh review of my symptoms, just still before I was aware of the trauma memories coming back. So I hadn't got anywhere with my neck. And I also wanted to have a fresh start and see a psychiatrist about my symptoms from my childhood. Wanted to go over my whole history and get a clean diagnosis, but not from a psychologist, but this time from a psychiatrist. So again, I had to pay for the referral, and I stated to my doctor, I don't want not in the area of ADHD, I just want a blank sheet, I want a fresh start without that tag. That was, I think that was bias. And she agreed, and again, I had to qualify for the specialist. And she'd referred me to an ADHD specialist. Now, she completely ignored what I'd stated, agreed to what I'd stated, and then done something different. So I'd qualified for the money and accepted the appointment. When I got there, I realised, oh, she's an ADHD specialist. And I said, well, I want to know this. She said, well, I don't pay for that, And I said, well, that's no good then. I've wasted my time. I had to go to Basingstoke. I had to walk miles to find this place. And I was traumatised from the car accident, still in shock, still really didn't want to get, the train journey was shaking my head around, I was really fatigued and worn down by it, and I was really, the stuff it knocked out of me, and plus it was triggering my post-traumatic stress more. I'd jump out of my skin when a car went past me. It's really difficult to go out in the daytime, so I used to go out for walks in the evening. And I get to this specialist and realise that she's an ADHD specialist. And I said, well, no, thank you very much. It's just a waste of time. And I left. Again, all the sessions, I paid for six sessions out of the money I qualified for. And I was a bit worried that, dishonestly taking all the money with not providing the service. So I told my doctor that and said, look, I didn't accept her. And she went, oh, silly me, I gave you a referral. referral to ADHD, and she just shrugged. And I said, well, are you going to change my record? You know, and also, would you correct my, what was done at the health centre? Because, you know, I was treated, they spent the money also, you know, are you going to do anything about it? And whether she did or not, I don't know. So, anyway, when my mum became ill, so that was my part of my care, and the lack of service and the just the way that the system had panned out with all the cuts and the overburden and overflux of patients at the surgery and you know, whipping Peter to pay Paul kind of thing. And then being told, oh, we haven't got the money, you know, for this, you know, I thought, well, you don't need to tell me you haven't got the money, it's not my problem. I've come in here for help, you can say you can help me or you can't. You can't, you don't lie to people and send them on false errands and then make money out of it. And then my mum got a brain tumour after she had breast cancer. Then she had a heart, she had an angina, she had a stent put in, and then she had a brain tumour. And she was treated in, she had a seizure, and then I called the ambulance, and then she had the initial assessment, she nearly died. And then she pulled through that, and then she got a referral to King George, and King George removed the tumour, but I was unable to travel because of my neck. And they, somebody had spread a rumour to the staff, because I found out that me and my father weren't interested. Well, my father couldn't drive, and I couldn't drive him, I couldn't drive a car. After my car accident, I couldn't get in a car. And I couldn't turn my neck properly, it was restricted. So we had to rely on lifts, and then no one would give, the hospital refused to give us a lift. And my family were making demands, and they didn't want to, they were reluctant to help. So I was left down to me, so I couldn't visit my mum, and I was too tired and fatigued and unable to get up to see her. But I did manage, I forced myself to get up to see her and went on the train. But again, the journey knocked me out because of all the shaking around of my head, and it caused me a lot of pain and symptoms. I was absolutely exhausted. But I managed to see her and found out that, you know, they had been under the impression that me and my dad weren't interested, which I wonder where that rumour come from. No, it's complete lies. So we was treated with a cold shoulder when I got there. I was anyway, my dad didn't come with me. And then the tumour was removed, and my mum, shortly after that, my mum's veins swelled up, and she had a big lesion, like a, it was like swelling, it was awful, like the size of a tennis ball on her calf. And I perceived it to do with medication for a stent or angina, so I took her to emergency doctor, which was our GP was on duty, Dr. Fairbank. And I remember vivid this day, I walked into the corner office, she weren't in her office, she was in the corner in the on the opposite side of the building, in an office, and she contemptuously looked at my mum, crossed her arms, and said, well, "What do you want me to do about it?" And I just walked my mum out of there without saying a word, and took my mum home, and that was that, you know. And I realised how she, you know, my mum recounting how she would patronise my mum and speak down to her, and not witnessing it myself, it doesn't really register, but then I saw the way she treated my mum, and then realised in hindsight the way she'd been treating me, exactly the same. But she never treated my dad like that. And you know that struck as odd, you know, why have we been singled out to be treated like that? You know, that's very strange. And then she's all lovely as pie to other people, but we were treated like two children. You know, it's completely patronising, and I'd disassociate, and it wouldn't register till I got out of the office and got home and thought, that's very strange. You know, I just thought that was the way way she was. But when I saw her treat my mum with that much contempt, it made me question even more. And then completely dismiss a serious bulging vein like that. And my mum was worried, I was worried. But subsequently the door went, you know, and that could have been orchestrated. And the door went, the dog jumped up, and because he used to get excited at the bark, he used to get frightened, because he was traumatised. And he'd get frightened at the door and just bark at the door. And he bashed into my mum's leg, and it burst, and she had a massive Venus wing. And so she went into the hospital. So I went to the hospital with her, and saw her through the initial assessment, and they were humming and hawing what to do, blah, 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 blah. I was telling them about her treatment in Guildford, where they were treating her for a stent and an angina. And that's where I think she was treated for her breast cancer also. And also had parts of her treatment for her brain tumour as well. But that was the consultants that were treating her for her angina. I think mainly at St. Mary's in Guildford. And I was trying to tell them of my mum's history, and that they need to, you know, correlate with them to find out what has caused it. And they kept deliberating, oh, your mum's not well enough to be treated. And my mum's suffering from dysphagia. She was on steroids to keep the swelling of her brain down. I knew all her medication because I was administering it. And I had a sheet and a discipline, so I knew what she was taking when she was taking it. And subsequently, all her pills went missing. All her painkillers, a whole massive box of painkillers went missing. Now I dropped my mum off, saw her into the ward, and thought, right, my mum will be alright for a minute, I need to go home and check my dad. And I told the staff in my mum's, who was on duty at that time, my mum's care, that I would be off to see my dad, and I would be back, straight back. But I had to walk, I didn't have any money for a taxi. Couldn't get a lift, so I quickly dashed home on foot, which was a few miles, and then saw my dad's alright, and then headed back. The time I got back, they'd stopped my mum's steroids. My mum was in a state, because she couldn't speak, but she was so frustrated and anxious that they'd stopped her medication. And in my mum's handbag, there's a legal notification under no circumstances stop the steroids, because that's what was keeping my mum's brain from not swelling. And I knew this, my mum knew this, because it's all explained. My mum was getting anxious and crying because she couldn't speak, but she could communicate. She wasn't dilally or encompass mentor. She knew what was going on, but she just couldn't articulate. Her dysphagia had all come out gobbledygook. So she was communicating to me what they'd done, and I could perceive what her frustration was about. And they mixed up all her medication, and a nurse, a junior nurse, had written that my mum had refused, and my mum hadn't refused. My mum was just trying to explain to them that they mucked up her medication and it was making her anxious. And I wanted to speak to someone in charge, but there was nobody available, just this young junior doctor. And I said, why have you written? She was at the bedside, and I saw her write it, and she refused medication. I said, well, my mum hasn't refused. And I gave my mum the tablets. My mum took them straight away, but she left it. My mum had refused medication, and the psychiatrist was called. And I thought, this is all a bit odd. He stopped. I said, why have you stopped my mother's, and this is on the first day, why have you stopped my mother's steroids? Under no circumstances should you just stop them. And then they said, then I spoke to a junior. I said, I want to see somebody right now. I want to see a consultant. I want to know what's going on. And they sent a junior partner, junior consultant. He came and see me, and I said, why have you stopped my mother's steroids? He said, oh, don't worry about that. wasn't listening, and he disappeared. And they were deliberating what to do about my mum's wound. Is she able to go through it? And you know, and my mum was just like, "Well, get on with it. You know, just get it treated, and I'll be fine." But they failed, for whatever reason, they failed to treat the wound, and it just got more infected as it went on. And we was told that there was no infection, that everything was all right, it's healing lovely, but it wasn't. My mum had a serious infection, then she got a bladder infection, then she's going to do lally, she's like hallucinating because of the urine, because of her infection, and the nurse pointed that out to us. Then they refused our antibiotics. Then she was, then I had to fight to get her home. And all the time, the first day I had arranged with a lovely matron who treated my mum, bandaged her leg lovely, got my mum comfortable and settled. But she would done the rounds ward to ward. She was only there briefly, and then she would go off another day on another ward. And it just went downhill after that, after the matron left the scene. But I arranged with the matron to get the authority that I could go and see my mum, because she couldn't speak, she was frustrated. I could see my mum out of visiting hours any time I liked, because the anxiety of my mother. So it was arranged by the matron and told to the staff. Now, the staff resisted it, they didn't like it. So every day I was told to get, you know, I'm not welcome. And I said, well, on your bike, you know, I didn't say that. I said, look, I've arranged this from the beginning, got the authority from a matron, so I had to go and get the matron and reassert what had been arranged, and the matron would confirm what she'd agreed and allow me back on the ward. She'd disappear, and then they'd start getting contentious again, ignoring me. Now, I was requesting, they still hadn't told my mother what was going on, and they hadn't told, informed me what was going on. I was the advocate of my mother's care, I was a legal guardian, because my dad was unable to deal with it. And I kept requesting to see a head consultant, and I was told to wait. I'd be there in about an hour, 15 minutes, waiting in the room. And I waited and waited. Nothing. And it was taking up all my visiting time. So I'd wait and wait and wait, and it just drawn out. Then I'd go and look for someone and said, well, where are they? And he said, oh, they've gone. You know, come back tomorrow. And I'd done the same thing day after day, waiting and being strung out, never ever seeing anybody to find out what was going on. All the time that was going on, my mum was passed from another ward, then another ward. And by that time, her bandages weren't being changed. I found my mum kicking her teeth along the ward and dirty bandages on. And I still hadn't seen the consultant, and this was running into about a month that my mum was in this hospital, not being treated. One day I found her crying, and she was able to speak. All of a sudden she could start speaking, and quite fluently. And she saw one of her school friends in the ward who was a nurse there, and she called out to her friend, and they had a little reunion. And my mother was crying out that she'd been abused in the night by this coloured nurse, this young girl. And that my mum had been cable tied to the bed, and she was so in such distress. She wasn't being treated, and my mum could articulate all this. So my mum knew how they were treating her. They'd stopped her steroids, so my mum's brain was swelling, and then they had got cheap to get a psychiatrist to deem my mum of an unfit mind. It was completely, to me, in hindsight, it looked staged. Like they staged the event to allow my mum to become her brain to swell, so that would affect her dysphagia, so she couldn't speak. So she was locked in this frustrating state, crying to get treated and get home. You know, she just had a tumour removed, and all she wanted to do was get into her own home. And I was trying to arrange it with these consultants, but they kept rebuffing me. And in the last ward she was in, I found her walking up the ward with all these dirty bandages around her leg. My mum had an infection, she was hallucinating, she didn't know her arse from her elbow. And I went to see, I walked up to the ward sister. I said, look, I want to know what's been going on. She looked at me coldly and turned around and walked through a locked door. And again, again, I hadn't seen anybody. And I kept fighting to see someone. Eventually, I got an appointment for Monday morning to see the head consultant. He's all smiles. And now, I didn't want to miss this appointment, but on that day, there was a severe overflood of traffic at Frimley. Now, it's never been that busy in the past. It's never been that busy since. It's completely blocked at every roundabout. So I fought to get, I couldn't get a parking space, couldn't get near the hospital. So eventually I abandoned the car in a private close, miles from the hospital, and walked to get to this appointment. And I was late, and I thought, oh no, you know, I really desperately need to do. So I wanted to get my mum home, and they hadn't treated her. So she'd been in all these weeks in the hospital, and they hadn't given her any treatment whatsoever. They'd just been bandaging over this infected wound, telling us that it was all healing nicely. And then I found my mum in such a state. And I said, look, I want my mum released today. And they said, well, we've got to make legal arrangements for her circumstances. You know, and I didn't challenge them. I could have said, well, you're not keeping the law. I could have just walked my mum out of there. But I complied, and I got all the house ready. And things were admitted that had been ordered for us to have in the home, and if it wasn't up to standard, they weren't going to release my mum. So I went, jumped all through the hoops, got her bed, a new bed, got all the chair heights adjusted, and they provided the toilet and everything. But the toilet was left off the van, you know, and that was deliberate. So I phoned up the hospital and said, get that, you better get that toilet here pronto, otherwise I'll be coming to get it. So the toilet was put on another delivery, and we got all the house able to be passed, and it was agreed that my mum was allowed out. But while I was having this consultation with these consultants I'd never seen before, so they said, oh, we're not going to release your mum unless you agree to sign the do not resuscitate if she has a seizure. And I just said, well, you know, I'll take care of my mum. They thought, I couldn't look after my mum. I said, well, I can look after my mum. So they'd been keeping her in there, not treating her, and they were just going to wait for her to snuff it, because they got me to sign. You know, that was my perception, because I was being kept from the consultancy. And they were just stringing it out until my mum would die. I'm pretty certain of it, the way she was being treated. And then they could just write it up as nothing untoward. So I had to agree that they weren't going to let her out of the hospital. So if they weren't going to let her out of the hospital, they weren't going to that's why they weren't treating her, because they didn't want to spend the money on her. And I said, look, she's crying. You haven't treated her. She's coming home. They said, well, you've got to sign the you've got to agree to carry the do not resuscitate certificate. And I said, well, give it here. And so they agreed to let my mum out, then I met all the conditions. So I realised that they were just keeping in there under false pretences and not having any intention in treating her, hence why they kept passing her from one ward to another. Then I was shocked to discover, turned up at the door, the sister who was on the ward when I had my collapsed lung was now the head of the palliative care. And that was only 2 years previous. I thought, well, that's a pretty... She was very alarmed to see me. She said, I know you somewhere. She was worried by it. She saw me and recognised me. And I didn't let on that I'd recognised her, but I did. I knew she was a sister only, you know, in one area. And now she's like the head boss of all the palliative care. And then the doctor who contemptuously treated my mum at the emergency appointment was now the head matron of palliative care. I thought, well, this is all a bit untoward. And they were legally bound to the conditions of the care approach, were that they had to change my mum. You know, we had to meet all the legal requirements, and so did our doctors and the nurses, community nurses. And they were were supposed to bandage my mother's leg every day. That was the legal condition. They didn't. They done it every other day. And when they come round, I kept asking, what's my mum's, the state of my mum's leg? How's the wound doing? Oh, it's lovely, don't worry, it's healing lovely. They kept saying that, and they kept saying that. And they would ask me to go out the house while they changed the bandage. And I said, well, why? They said, oh, it's your mum's dignity. I said, well, it's not like you've been changing her genitals or her breasts or anything. It's only a calf. So they were using my mum's dignity, so I was kept from seeing the... I know what an infection looks like, I'm not stupid. So they didn't want me to see the state of her infection. So they were just bandaging these clean bandages every other day, knowing that they were concealing an infection. And so they were party to it. So they had knowledge of my mum wasn't treated in hospital. Obviously the buck had been passed on to them, and they thought, well, we're not wasting money on it. Then I heard the head nurse speak to Olive Fairbairn on the phone about my mum's got a bladder infection. She come out with a bladder infection. And I heard the doctor say, oh, I don't, you know, no, I'm not giving her any medication. I heard the cold conversation, and the nurse said, Olive, the son is listening, he can hear. And it went all quiet, you know, so I'd overheard the conversation. And so we had all this other voluntary carers in to wash my mum. Now, I wasn't getting invited to the care plan approach, which completely kept out the loop. My mum refused these women touching her. My mum wanted to wash herself, but they wouldn't let it. So I wrote to these people and said, you know, this is not helping, my mum's refusing to be washed by these people. Stop sending them round, and I'll arrange for mum's sister to do it. And they just kept turning up, and they ignored our request. And my mum kept pushing them away, so my mum wasn't getting a wash anyway. So they were just going through the motions all the time that these people, every other day, were changing their false bandages. Well, one night, my mum fell off the bed and I had to call a paramedic to help her, to pump her back up on her, because I couldn't lift her. And so I had to call a paramedic, and they had one of the inflatable seats that she got my mum back onto bed, and she gave my mum a full medical, and she was really concerned. She said, did you know that your mum's oxygen's like really low? And she told me about the infection, the blood infection. Then she told me about her leg infection, and it's serious, and she was saying that this is complete neglect. She wrote a report, and I told her what she'd been through. She basically said, well, you need to stand up to these people, they're not doing what they should be doing. And she left me a full medical document, all ticked off and all signed. She said, hide that. She said, because that will show the neglect. Put it in a safe place, and I hid it in a safe place. And thought nothing of it and carried on going through the motions of this palaver, because we could perceive that all they wanted to do is you'd be better off in Phyllis Tuckwell, Wendy, you know. My mum was refusing to have a catheter, and they just wanted to get into Phyllis Tuckwell as quickly as possible. That was all they were pressuring for all the time. So had this pressure over us, you know, it's like they're hovering over us waiting to get my mum into Phyllis Tuckwell. We know what goes on in Phyllis Tuckwell, we're not stupid. We've seen so many accounts about that place, you know, and they say, oh, it's just fear. It's not fear, it's a fact, you know, it's a place you can be bumped off. And so my mum was resisting, and resisting to be washed, resisting to, she's just stubborn, she was making a rough for her own back and making it worse for me. And I was sleeping on tender hooks and at her beck and call, you know, to look after her and administer her medication. And eventually, I kept being pressured in to have a night nurse in. You know, the nurses said, oh, Andrew, you need a break. You want to get a, we're providing. kept pressuring me, and eventually I relented. One of these Mary Curie nurses, gave my mum a sedative, I think it was two, and there was no problems with the first one, but the second nurse that I allowed to take care of my mum in the evening was another Mary Curie nurse, and I walked in on her administering my mum a medication. My mum was like, one minute I was speaking to my mum, because my mum's speech was fine, and my mum was like sagging like she's drunk a bottle of whiskey. One minute she's alright, and the next minute she's like all over the place. And I said, well, what are you giving my mum? She said, oh, just a sedative, help her sleep. And I believed her. Now, I didn't sleep that night, and I basically kept an eye on what was going on, going up and downstairs, looking through the door, and seeing that my mum had settled, and this nurse was, you know, awake, sitting on the sofa. And in the morning, on her way out, she put a needle in the sharps box, and on the way out of the kitchen, she slapped a vial of midazepam, which was only to be, I knew what it was for. Now the pharmacist was quite concerned about some of my mum's drugs, and there was something to do there. But this midazepam was an emergency in case my mum had a brain seizure, and it was to jolt the brain into activity. It was only a last resort. 2 milligrams, I still got the vial. And it was spitefully, on her way out, she went, you can get rid of that, and slapped it on the counter and left immediately, got in her car and drove off. And I thought, why didn't she just throw that in the sharps box or put that in the bin herself? Why did she want me to see it? And when I saw it was the midazolam vial, and I knew my mum had a seizure that night, what had she done? Had given my mum, administered my mum this injection for absolutely no reason, and I believe it was to get my mum into Phyllis Tuckwell to induce a seizure, because my mum wasn't right after that. And she hadn't had a seizure, and this was a voluntary Mary Curie nurse. Now, I perceived that they were pressuring me in to have these doctors in, just so that they could do the dirty and get my mum into Phyllis Tuckwell to finish her off, to cover up the fact that they're not treating her for infection. So it was round raided. Then I got, when they come round to collect all their stuff, the nurses are supposedly to collect all the bandages, because I left all their bandages out in boxes on the side, and they were supposed to come round after my mum had died, and when my mum was in Phyllis Tuckwell, to collect them. And I think this after she died, passed away, and they come round to get all the stuff. And bearing in mind that the paramedics report, now when my mum was, after that vial, my mum just agreed, she said, look, I've had enough, I know what's going on, they're just trying to get rid of me. She said, oh, I'm going to just go into Phyllis Tuckwell and get it over and done with. And I said, well, if that's what you want, that's what was agreed. And then my mum went to Phyllis Tuckwell, she died within a week, you know. And when she got to Phyllis Tuckwell, we was informed, did you know your mum had a serious leg infection? And I said, no, that's, well, I did know, but that's the first officially the time, apart from the paramedic, that I found about it. So in the hospital, she didn't have an infection. In our home, she didn't have an infection, but Phyllis Tuckwell were honest and said, well, she has got an infection. And, the leg wound was seriously infected. And the paramedic confirmed that and given me the report. So after my mum's death, the nurses were coming around to collect all their stuff. And as a distraction, I got a phone call from the head nurse, Carol, while the other nurses collected their stuff. Now, while the phone was upstairs, so I took the phone call upstairs while they were collecting their stuff. And Carol said to me, we've had a report from that one of the night nurses that you'd been taking your mum's painkillers refused to give your mum medication. You wouldn't do that, would you, Andrew? And I knew that they were twisting my arm and threatening to make a false report about me if I said anything, you see. So they were putting the frighteners on me. And that if I said anything, they were suggesting that they were going to give a false report that I'd refused my mum medication. You wouldn't do that, would you, Andrew? And I said, you know damn well I wouldn't do that. And I hung up. And as I went downstairs, the nurses had finished, they were on their way out. They'd left all their stuff, they hadn't collected it, they collected their files, and they hadn't collected their stuff, and I was kind of like taken back by that, and thought, well, why haven't they come out to do what they're in a hurry? And then I couldn't figure out why they're trying, why they hadn't taken the bandages and the scissors and the lint and all the stuff. They'd just taken my mum's medical reports, their medical notes. And I thought, that's a bit odd. And then I suddenly got the concern, I better check the paramedics report, because I was on the end of what they were up to, so I knew that was my only evidence to show that they'd neglected my mother, because of the consultation I had with the paramedic and what she told me and what she documented for me as evidence, and give me the carbon copy the full copy and the carbon copy, and signed it, and I placed it right under the back of the bureau, right on the floor level, so they would have had to get a stick to reach it. You can put your arm under it and reach to the back of the floor to get it, because it's right up against the skirting. And I thought, oh no, I had a horrible thought, oh, I better check to see if that paramedic report's there. And then I checked and it was missing. And I thought, oh, how on earth did they know where that was? You know, how do they know where I put that, unless they had a means of seeing into our home when we weren't there? Now, I know about radiation, and they can point cloud, they can map the points where radiation hits objects, human objects, and then they can pinpoint and plot on the computer a three-dimensional image of where you are in the room. It's like an x-ray. You know, the police have got that technology, the military got that technology, but I was completely oblivious of all this at this time. But I couldn't figure out how they knew where to look for, immediately go to the point where I'd hid it. You know, they didn't discover it by chance. They, in the time that I was on the phone to the time that they were in and out, they went straight for it. They must have done. So they knew exactly where it was. And then that's why they were in a hurry to leave, and they left all their stuff behind. And I thought, that's a bit odd. And then discovering that they'd taken the file, you know, that's another thing that got my suspicions up. So that was the and the threatening phone call, the indirect threatening phone call, the refusal to give my mum antibiotics, and the treatment of Dr. Fairburn, the strangeness that she was the head of palliative care, along with this Caroline, who was a you know, only a year or two previous, she was a ward sister, now she was the chief executive of the palliative care team for Phyllis Tuckwell and the whole area. And along side by side with my GP, who was a matriarch of the palliative care, directing all the nurses. So the nurses were in on it. They planted a dirty witch, Mary Curie nurse, so they were... They could have access to who, what nurse that they could call up for voluntary duty to plant into our home to give my mum that midazepam, which was it wasn't called for, and I don't even know if they're qualified to do that. That was in an emergency, and it wasn't an emergency because I was in the room. I knew what. I'd witnessed my mum have seizure. She weren't having a seizure because I was speaking to my mum. My mum was speaking to this nurse. And then the next minute, you know, so she obviously lied to my mum, said, I'll give you a sedative to help you sleep, and gave her this midazepam. And then coldly and cruelly slapped the vial on the kitchen counter on her way out of the door, and then drove off. So I never see her again. I didn't know her name.
And they were pressuring me to get these people into the home, and reluctantly I allowed it. And now in hindsight I can see why, because they wanted to get her into Phyllis Tuckwell, get my mum so poorly that it was just no hope, and then they could finish her off. And then she died moments, you know, it was only a few days into being at Phyllis Tuckwell. She was drugged off and died. You know, and they said it was her brain. I don't believe that. And then having the threat on the phone, I was too traumatised to really tackle it or deal with it. So then, 2 years later, you know, I'm looking for a GP. I see Dr. Fairbairn briefly after that, and I told her, oh, I discovered, wanted to tell her why I had, that I'd realised. I wanted to go in there and find out my blood type, but she didn't want to let me know that for some reason. And I wanted to tell her that I discovered what my symptoms were. It was post-traumatic stress, and she went, oh, I didn't, you know, and her lip, she turned her lip down, oh, some of the didn't kind of thing. I thought, you patronising bitch. And then I left, and 2 years later, I thought, I want to, now recovering from my trauma, understanding it, starting to grasp it, pull the pieces together and pull my socks up, and thought, well, I need to just recover from this. And recovering from my cut, I'm still today suffering from serious symptoms from my neck, with my neck and my back. I get sore, I get pins and needles, I get numb shoulder blades, I get tension in my back of my neck, I wake up with like I've been batted over the head. I can't put my weight on my head on the pillow, and my head is all lollipy and it crunches, and all my diaphragm clicks when I swallow, it's painful to swallow, and all my jowls have popped out. And I was completely not given any treatment and sent around the houses, and never received the proper avenues into the hospital to get the proper, you know, analysation to get to check the symptom severity, or to actually have any internal examination. I was just brushed off with whiplash, or it's my posture, you know. My posture is because I was in so much discomfort that I couldn't hold my head up straight. And I was doing that by my muscles, because my tendons were so damaged that it wouldn't support my head in the neutral position it usually would. And I had this bone sticking out the back of my neck that was really sore, causing me a lot of discomfort and pain. And I was getting this jolting up in bed at night, and getting these waking up these serious headaches. Thumping headaches, because I couldn't sleep properly. I couldn't put my head on the pillow. So 2 years after seeing Dr. Fairbairn last, I thought, all right, I'm going to investigate. I started looking back and discovering about this electronic targeting. I'd also experienced some, all the electronic harassment in the home. I personally believe it was the neighbours who directly next door to us. And then I was getting this high level readings in the house, and then I was started to be followed. Went up to the petrol station because I was to go for a walk in the evening, because my neck. And then I saw this laptop light come on in the woods as I walked past. So they were allowing, it was to me as though these people were allowing me to see them. And then I was being followed after that, tracked wherever I walked, and followed by pairs of people, the same, a man and a woman, in like couples. Now two would peel off and two would appear. And then I learned that this is a military technique and process. So these people would let me know that they were tracking me, and wherever I walked they could know where I was, my location. And I believe that was from, now coming out of hospital from my collapsed lung, they never signed me in properly, they never, you know, give me the introduction. questions. On the last day I was being released, I saw this woman walk up the ward, strolling up the ward really fast in a polythene overall, one of those pink disposable overalls. Didn't know who she was, complete stranger. Walks on the ward, walks past me on my bed, and I was on the end in the corner. She went past the bed and then into the corner, and then come up behind me and stuck a swab in my mouth and hurried off. And I called out to her, "What's that for? What did you do? Why have you taken a mouth swab? You know, that's my DNA." "Oh, it's for, you know, a superbug or something like that." And I said, "Well, I'm going out, you know, I was going out today. Why are you doing that now?" But she just walked off, never even replied. Just quickly come in the ward, done the dirty and walked off. And I thought, that's very suspicious. Who is this woman? That could have been a disease on the swab that they'd given me. You know, how do I know what they're up to? No one was paying attention in the hospital or the ward. And this stranger walks on up the public strolls up the corridor and done that to me. And I thought, well, what's all that about? Now, I perceive that perhaps they were getting my DNA, and then from my DNA they could track me. You know, I know this it's called CELDAR, this technology is, it's been documented how they can track your body signature, and from satellite, from CELDAR, cell towers, because you're like it's like a radar. And I was getting all these accurate people following me and suggesting to me that they own me, and so I was getting all this persecution. And I started investigating all this and researching, and discovered about the military intelligence and Barry Trauer and some other experts who studied all this in the military, and then learning about the technology, and then discovering that this has been going on in America, how they target people, how they can give people brain tumours. And then I started to feel, well, you know, our house was live, and I could, and that was quite alarming levels of radiation, electronic radiation. And then I realised it isn't safe, it's dangerous, and it can cause so many different glaucoma. My dad had glaucoma, and that went away all of a sudden. So, you know, glaucoma is a symptom of your eyes swelling up, so that can be generated by electronic magnetic radiation. And we were getting, our house was live, I had several meters and measuring the levels in the home. That went on for years, and that was going on while my mum was at home, so that could have been the cause of her brain tumour. You know, and the doctor blurted out of her mouth, "I was being a spate of brain tumours recently," when my mum was diagnosed, you know. So that was suspicious. So, you know, directed for the conditions to create a tumour in my mum's brain? Was our house targeted? Because once I got all the measurements, knew of the technology and the machinations and methodologies of how these people can be covertly targeted. Neighbours can do it, you know, criminals can do it. But to find out that government bodies are doing it, military bodies are doing it, private bodies are doing it, so I don't know who it was, but I was on the end of this electronic harassment through the wall, and then I was followed up the road. So at the time I wanted to discover what had taken place with being struck off that surgery at Jenner House, and what happened to that doctor. And I wanted to just find out if they had any records. So I went online and saw that Dr. Fairbairn was there. Now, Dr. Fairbairn was at the head of the Alexander House surgery 1 minute when I last saw her, and 2 years later when I'm looking, and I was looking for a new GP because I didn't want to have anything to do with that surgery because of the history, as I've explained, with my care and my mother's care and the way we were treated. And so while I was on the website, and I was only looking on the website, I didn't push any buttons or anything, so immediately after that, me and my dad get notified that Dr. Fairbairn had left. Well, I'd already known that, because I just discovered it myself by accident. And our new doctor was Dr. Marshall. Now, this is when I wrote and complained that I don't want to be registered with that doctor, and I gave the reasons why I've just given them to in this witness. And I didn't want to be registered for that doctor, so I wrote the reasons. I told her about Dr. Barrack and the events and the biasness of the way Dr. Fairbairn treated me, and then my mum's care. And I said, absolutely not, I want you to unregister me. And that's when then she phoned me and called me paranoid. And then I started putting two and two together. So I know that it's the underhandedness. I don't fully know her motives, but her motives were, why hasn't she unregistered me? Then I didn't hear anything for a year after a threatening phone call, and she sent people from Southwood round. Now, I didn't know they were from Southwood until, they didn't tell me who they were or where they come from. I had to dig it out of them on the doorstep. And they wouldn't really directly tell me why they'd come round. They gave an indirect reason. And they never said that Dr. Marshall had sent them. They just said they'd just come round. And in such a state, and agitated, because I knew it wasn't sincere, it wasn't to do with my health, it's to do with Dr. Marshall. She had refused, and she threatened me on the phone, made out that I was delusional or paranoid. Oh, you're paranoid, Dr. Barrett doesn't even exist. I said, what do you mean Dr. Barrett doesn't exist? It will be on the medical report in Frimley Park Hospital, and so will Dr. Rutherford be. So why don't you go and check it out, and then, don't call me paranoid. You go and check out the evidence I've stated. And I didn't hear anything. And then a few days later, I get these two women come round with badges, and I could perceive one was a GP and one was a social worker. I don't know if that's a fact. In case of fact, they might have just been community carers, but they had NHS badges. I know social workers carry them and GPs do at the doorstep. So, I can only presume what they were and why they were around. They were around to ask me and then to deem me if my health was unstable, because that's what they'd been referred to come around by this Dr. Marshall, or Dr. Irwin, in fact. I think Dr. Irwin was senior over Dr. Marshall. Dr. Marshall, I don't know who's instigated the concern, whether it's Dr. Marshall, because when Point of Access phoned me, they didn't tell me who the GP was that referred me. They said, my GP. Well, I haven't got a GP, because I refused registration from Dr. Marshall over 2 years ago, and I have not had any written response. And then following a year from initially writing and getting a threatening phone call, and these two people turn up my door in what I believe is an attempt to section me and say, oh, he's unstable. Plus, I was getting all this electronic harassment at the door to trigger my anxiety and post-traumatic distress, to get me into such a state that they could monitor, be aware of that state when they turn up at the door. And knowing it will aggravate me, the phone call aggravate me, so that these doctors must be aware of post-traumatic stress and triggers, so they knew that phone call would, if they don't, they're stupid, they're idiots. But I believe they're fully aware of what they were doing. And then why didn't they just write back to me and confirm that I was no longer their GP? Why send somebody around concerned about my mental health from another surgery, and them hiding behind their back, admitting to tell me who they were and why they were sent? They just asked to come in. And I said, well, who are you? Why are you around here? Then they had to tell me, you see. Then they had to, then I said, well, why haven't you, did you read my letter that I wrote to Dr. Marshall? And, I asked to be unregistered. And have you checked out what I was saying was true? Because I'm not paranoid. I want you to verify that event happened with Dr. Barrack and all the things I stated about with Dr. Fairbairn. Obviously they were trying to cover it up and then deem me mental so they could section me. Then I've got no rights, and then I'm in their pocket, and then I'm in closed doors, and then I have no one has any idea who treating me or who could have access to me. So this has really agitated me and causing me a lot of stress. So hence why I'm doing this video. So 2 years after the event, a year after I wrote to Dr. Marshall, I reiterated what I stated I'd like my medical records changed, which I've explained, the false being put on, from Basingstoke, being put on a medication that I never even agreed to take, and that doctor writing it up as if I'd accepted the treatment. So I wanted that record corrected, and also with my accident and the false diagnosis I was given at Aldershot Health Centre, that it was my posture, I wanted that corrected, and I still need treatment for it, and I need a proper diagnosis to find out what internal injuries I've got. You know, I'm not after suing these people, I just want the truth. I can get on with my life. But that's been refused me, and I've been sent around the houses, and I wanted that biases any future medical care. When I look for a new doctor, they pick up my file, and they're going to see that, they're going to react on that. They're not going to necessarily take my word for it, so I've got to regurgitate all this and challenge it. You know, that's not fair to dump on another GP. You know, this should have been dealt with, and that's what I was requesting, just to put the record straight. And that's what I requested for Dr. Marshall, and then all this dirty underhandedness happened. So I wrote a year after the first letter, again requesting for my to be unregistered, and this time my dad, because my dad had agreed by this time, after speaking to him in length about, to consider what my mum went through, the association to that surgery, and it wasn't a good idea, and my dad kind of agreed. He said, yeah, I agree with you, and I can see that you're right, and he said, would you write it, and I'll sign it. So I done that. Well, actually, I proposed it to him. I said, look, I'll write it for you, would you read it, and if you agree to it. I said, don't do it if you don't agree to it, but he did agree to it, and he agreed that if I write it, he would sign it, and that's what he'd done. There was no pressure, or I didn't put him in under any duress, but I stated the seriousness of having those people having that surgery make decisions after the way they treated my mother, and covered it up, so we did not want any association to them. And that doesn't mean that Dr. Marshall would have been complicit or bad, it's just I didn't want to take any risks. You know, it just brings it all up again, and then for them to deny Dr. Barrack ever being there, and then to be challenged and patronised by Dr. Earle to state that I was paranoid, that this doctor never existed. Well, she's either being lied to, but she had no right to treat me like that on the phone. There was no record of the phone call, and there was no confirmation or acknowledgement of that letter. You know, isn't it the law that if you write to somebody, they have to officially respond back to the letter? You know, I didn't get any such acknowledgement. I'm left in the dark, and these strangers turn up concerned about my mental health. Well, what have they been discussing without me, without my input? How dare they? They don't even know me. They haven't even bothered to approach me. They wouldn't help me when I did approach them, and now they're suddenly concerned for my health. It's disgusting. So I rewrote a year later, having heard nothing, thought I'll give it one more try, I'm not hopeful. Reiterated it all, you know, in a roundabout way, blurted it all out, because it's not been dealt with, so I've got to regurgitate it all, hence why I'm putting it all in one go on a video. And then again, I haven't heard anything. This was in November. And then on Christmas Eve, I get a phone call from Point of Access. Oh, we've been referred by your doctor. And I said, I haven't got a doctor. You know, out of the blue, I'm on the phone. I'm triggered by the phone and the intrusion. And what's going on in the background, I'm on the end of. I don't know what these people have been told. They're not told the whole picture. That's why I'm making this video, so they can have a copy of it. Because I'm not being bullied, or them using the law, getting a police officer and a social worker to kick my door down and have me sectioned. I don't know what their intentions are, who's behind it. And if that's the way Dr. Earle or Dr. Marshall behaves, she shouldn't be practicing. This is totally abuse of malpractice, abuse of her rights and her office. So I'd be suing if they come round trying to section me, you know, and I'd be getting advocacy to, I'm not, you know, I can't cope with going to court. It just put my nerves through too much. As this is aggravating me. I'm not being able to settle because I'm not concerned. What dirty play's going on? What dirty games are going on? So point of access, you know, they don't explain. They don't want to tell me anything. Why? Because I'm not a professional. Well, I'm the bloody patient. Excuse my language. You know, I have a right to be consulted, and I have a right to choose who can care for me and who can't. And I certainly don't trust these people. They're completely blind. They're not interested. You know, they claim to be experts in post-traumatic stress, yet they trigger you and aggravate you and threaten you on the phone, call you paranoid. It's complete lies. Who are these dirty people? So again, I was refused to be unregistered, and so was my father. So, you know, as far as they're concerned, they're acting as though they're our doctor. They're not our doctor. They're breaking the law, and they're certainly not my doctor. I have not authorised it. They can't force me to be their doctor. You know, and if that's the rules, why aren't we explaining the rules? Why isn't anyone else explaining the rules? Doctors are voluntary. I can go and get a private doctor. You can't just register yourself and claim that you're our doctor and then refer us to a mental health team. It's obviously dirty play, and I'm not allowing it. I'm not accepting it, and I'll be handing this witness to anyone who comes to the door with an account of all the other things that have been happening. So that's my medical history. My brother's suspicious death, my mother's suspicious death, and my treatment. So, you know, the question is, well, what are their motives showing? Because it's not showing complicitness to what I've requested to be signed off. And why are they using their authority to say that I'm paranoid and mental? You know, are they just using that as a feeble concern to cover up a more nefarious activity? You know, who are these people? You know, this isn't innocent behaviour. This is willful admission of the truth. They know what they're doing, and they're not genuinely concerned about my mental health, because they've never been concerned in the past when I've gone for help. So why are they suddenly caring now? No, this is dirty handedness. So I won't be accepting this treatment from anybody, especially point of access. You know, and I won't be ram raided by the law behind you. You're breaking the law. I challenge it. So I'm going to close this video now. So rolling on. So praise my Lord Jesus Christ for, you know, being my advocate and my support. And I'm going to close in this.